Welcome, my friends, to the Sage Aquarius Radio Hour, your home for free and critical thinking, and I'm your host, Mike Williams. Tonight, my very special guest is Patricia Steer. Patricia is the host of the popular YouTube channel Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, and she is also a vegan, which is the topic of the show tonight. The discussion with Patricia is wide-ranging as she offers her insights into the benefits of the vegan diet and lifestyle. During our conversation, we do discuss the treatment of animals as part of the human food supply. Some listeners may find this part of the show disturbing, but it is the reality of how meat and dairy end up on our kitchen tables. And so without further ado, here's Patricia Steer. Patricia, welcome back to the show. I mentioned before we got online here that it was exactly 2 years ago, back in January of 2016, when you came on my show. And then I later was a guest on yours. It was back in May of 2017. So time flies when you're having fun.
Yes. And we saw each other in Raleigh, North Carolina in person as well.
We did.
So this is the fourth time that we shall meet.
Yes. And I'm sorry that we didn't really connect during the conference. You were very busy with doing a lot of interviews and really the breaks weren't that long.
Flat Earth International Conference is what we're talking about. I didn't even mention what it was where we saw each other
in
Raleigh.
Yes, exactly.
We weren't just hanging out in Raleigh. It was a big event in November of 2017. Another one's coming up in Denver in 2018.
Patricia, I asked you to come on the show because I know you're a vegan. And so tonight, folks, we're going to get into health. And I've asked Patricia to come on and to take us through veganism. Myself, I'm not a vegan, but I am a pescatarian. So I'm making my way there. And I haven't had meat in probably now anywhere between 9 to 10 months. The hardest part of it, Patricia, was making the decision to not have meat anymore, to eat meat. And that's because, you know, your whole life, that's the diet that you were on and all that. But then once I made the switch, it was really pretty much smooth sailing. I never looked back. I don't think to myself, well, I wish I can have a hamburger. I just do not think that way. So, but you said that you had become a vegan before Flat Earth. Now, Flat Earth was, I guess, came on the scene about 3 years ago. So when did you become a vegan and why did you decide to go that way?
I don't have the exact date, but I was vegetarian before I went vegan. And I'm going to guess that I went vegan in 2013, but I don't even know how I could figure out when I went vegan, but 2013. Before that, I was vegetarian. And before that, I was a regular average American eating everything. I grew up on meat and dairy. I grew up half of my childhood in Michigan and half of it in Florida and, meat and dairy and meat and potatoes and, you know, the regular routine of baked chicken and steaks. And I just ate like a normal American. I remember my mom giving me 75 cents in the 70s to go ride my 10-speed bicycle to the local store to grab a gallon of milk every now and then. I think she gave me a dollar and I spent the remaining change on like the penny candy that they had there. So that was really healthy. But I remember milk as we need milk. You need to go get milk, Patty. And, I was the eldest and I'd ride my bike and get the milk. And we had a full glass of milk at every meal. And my mother was always very much making sure we had a balanced diet using at the time the food pyramid, which was the standard. And milk was a big part of it. She was always focused on protein. And to my mom, a very intelligent woman with a master's degree, protein came from animal products. But we didn't think of them as, quote, animal products. They were the eggs that were in the carton at the grocery store. They were, the pork chops that came sealed in the sanitary packaging, very bloodless, that you found in the meat section. So these things were very removed from animals. I didn't grow up on a farm. No one in my family hunted. So I never really saw the process by which a living creature becomes something on my plate that I stab with a knife.
I can tell you that my switch took place after I watched a documentary. I watched a documentary on how our meat is produced, mm-hmm. which means the slaughterhouses and all that. And I have to be honest, Patricia, I never got through the entire documentary. I got a little way through and I started seeing how this was going to roll out. And I did watch some of the footage and that was that. I said,
yes.
I can't do it anymore because our culture, like you mentioned growing up, I grew up the same way. We're so detached from understanding how the food is produced, how it's created. And so you don't think anything of it. I mean, you just go to the supermarket and you buy your milk and you buy your meat and, you know, and you go back home and you have a barbecue or whatever it is. You just don't know. But once you do know, it becomes very, very difficult. I know I've mentioned to some folks, I will say to them that I don't eat meat. And they kind of look at you, a little bit, a little strange maybe, like, wait, when did you stop eating meat? And I said, well, and I'll tell them, why did you decide to do that? And I will start to tell them I watched a documentary, and many people will say, oh, well, okay, yeah, I don't want to go there. I don't
Right.
want to go there. I don't want to know that.
Willful ignorance comes into play when the eyes glaze over and people back away from you.
Yeah.
And it's a fine line. And I know you're not vegan, but I'll speak as a vegan. I don't want to be that pushy vegan that people always say that everywhere I go, I'm always saying, hi, I'm vegan. I don't do that. And I'm only here on your show because you asked me to speak on veganism. And, I occasionally do drop little bits of vegan information into my YouTube channel, which isn't a vegan channel per se. It's called Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. At least it's got a vegetable in there as opposed to a meat product in the name. But, I do mention veganism, and most people who've listened to any videos I've done figured out I am vegan. But I don't push it on people. I provide information and then people can decide themselves. But I don't know what documentary you're speaking of. I'm curious. There's one called Earthlings, which I recommend anyone try. I think you could maybe get it on Netflix, or you can also see it on YouTube for free. Earthlings is quite dramatic. I've never been able to see it all the way through. I found out about it after I was vegan, so didn't need to. There's another one called Cowspiracy, which is much lighter in tone, easier to watch. One called Forks Over Knives that I would recommend, and one called Vegucated that I also recommend people take a look at. And I'm sure these can be found on Amazon or, wherever finer movies about not killing animals are sold.
Yeah, the one I watched was on YouTube. I don't recall the title of it, but they just jumped right in.
Oh, yeah.
It was really a shock.
Well, we know they die. That's how they get on our plate. But I remember as a child, even in nursery school, being taken to a farm with all the other little children.
Yeah.
And we would pat the cows and look at the chickens. And then we'd go home, and most likely mom would be making veal for you for dinner that night or whatever the case may be. But I never connected the two.
Right. Yeah, making the connection, that's the part that, we're just not acclimated to that because
programming,
exactly. We're conditioned not to think about that. Go to the supermarket. It's all packaged. It's got, nice packaging and
pictures of happy animals, too. There are grocery stores and advertisements on TV and signs that you might see for steakhouses or chicken places. And there's a smiling chicken, sometimes even holding a frying pan. And when you think about it, so the chicken's on the sign holding a frying pan where he's going to fry himself and his friends. It just sounds ridiculous when you look at it. But we've removed ourselves from these creatures and we consider them products. And I think that's wrong, but I did the same thing. And so therefore, I have no animosity toward anybody who eats meat or dairy products or fish or what have you, because I did the same thing. I found out more information. And with that information, I made the choice to change my way of life. And I chose to do it for the animals. Health is a secondary benefit. I was already healthy and slim before and still am, but other people have seen great health benefits from going vegan. So people who become vegan, not really for the animals, they even say sometimes I don't care about animals. I just do it so I don't have a heart attack. I'm all for that as well. Anything that causes a change in our consciousness and makes for a better world, I'm all for.
Yeah, I don't evangelize either. And like again, I'm not a vegan, folks. I don't eat meat, but I do eat fish. And I do have some dairy. I don't have a lot of dairy. But Patricia, one of the things that I thought about was, a lot of people have pets. I have a pet. I have my dog, Charlie. But animals are sentient beings.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you start to put it into that perspective, it makes it, at least for me, even more difficult to eat meat. Because they are living, breathing creatures. And so, again, I don't, like I said, I don't want to evangelize, but I'm just covering a little bit, and I know you're my guest, but I'm covering a little bit about how I kind of myself got there, and folks, the reason why I'm telling you that is because if I can do it, you can do it.
I used to love nothing more than going out to dinner on a Sunday night to the country club with my dad and my sister and brother. It was a routine to have. Here's what I ordered, and I'm talking at 9. A filet mignon, medium rare, a baked potato with chives and sour cream, and we would get escargot in garlic and butter on the side, or we would have a lobster tail. That's what I ate on a Sunday. And I thought nothing of any of that until one day, at one particular moment, that country club changed the way that they had the animals. I didn't think of them as animals, the food. And the waitress said, little girl, would you like to come pick your lobster? And I didn't understand really what that meant. And my dad said, go ahead. And I followed her to a big tank, like an aquarium. And there were these lobster, which I'd only seen maybe in pictures before as, you know, I'd never seen in real life, with their claws with rubber bands around them, floating kind of and swimming in this tank with others, quite crowded. And she said, pick the one you want. And I burst into tears, ran back to the table and said, Dad, I can't. Can we get one and put it in the bathtub so it can live with us at home? That was the first moment when my heart broke through my programming, but it was soon put to rest. I was back to eating all of that stuff later. I just never picked my own lobster again. But at that moment, had I been more of an aware and awake person, I would have made the giant connection. Or if I had had a family member or friend who was on that path, and I did not. My family were all staunch meat and dairy eaters. My brother, who's 4 years younger, 4 years younger than me, he is a vegetarian and has been for many, many years. That changed me. I understood, but I forgot, went back to sleep and started eating those things again. And then when I was 15, I met this older boy who seemed very wise. He was probably 16, not so wise, but at the time. And I admired him. He started talking to me about what libertarianism was. I've never heard anyone talk about that sort of thing before, especially a boy at that age who, you know, doesn't care for anything more than, you know, listening to music at that age. And this age, it would be playing video games. And he told me about libertarianism, and I thought, wow, this guy's so smart. And he also told me about vegetarianism and animals. And I listened intently and very much believed in what he was saying and went home and told my mother, Mom, I don't want to eat meat anymore. And my mother said to me, how are you going to get your protein? That was the first thing. And the second thing was, I'm not going to be cooking a separate meal for you. And I said, well, just cook the same meal for me. Just don't give me the meat. And I did that for a while and then, you know, went back to eating the normal stuff because I didn't have the internet at that time to show me all the gory details about things. And I believe that the advent of YouTube, in fact, more than anything else, we have a window into that very secret world of the slaughterhouse that none of us ever had before. Slaughterhouses don't have windows. They don't have, you know, glass walls. If they did, none of us would be able to probably eat meat unless you were really, really sadistic.
Well, even the way they keep the animals in the cages when they're transporting them, like down in here in North Carolina, we have the farms and all, and a lot of times you'll see the trucks and you'll have the pigs or the chickens in these very, very little confined boxes or containers, and yes, they're all stacked up on these trucks and, you know, they're on the highway, and it's really very, very sad to see.
They're on their way to the death camp. Where they were before that wasn't too much better. Most farms, believe it or not, are factory farms. Most farms aren't the farm that you hear about, old McDonald's kind of farm where there's a farmer's wife who's milking the cow and, you know, and the happy little chicks. It's a whole different story. Even if you buy locally from a farmer, for the most part, the animals are farmed in factory farm conditions, very large ones and very small ones, where the process of the way the animals are kept and raised and killed is something that I do want to talk about here because I don't think a lot of people know, and I certainly did not know, and I think it needs to be known. And once again, I do want to say what you had said before. You're not here to evangelize. I'm not here as a preachy vegan. This is a show about veganism. Therefore, these are the topics that will be discussed. I would say if you're not interested in this, this of all of your shows isn't the one for you. But I think that all of the people who follow you are interested in gaining knowledge on every subject. And this one, because it's what we put in our mouths and it in many people's beliefs is a personal choice. It's, I guess, for many people taboo to even discuss the fact that, well, I don't eat meat anymore or I'm a vegan. I don't see why that should be taboo. People are discussing things like boxers and briefs. Well, that's perfectly acceptable. Or, you know, openly discussing sex toys, you know, in the office. That's fine. But we can't discuss the food we eat and where it comes from. Oh, no. Oh, no.
Yeah, that's because it leans into people's belief systems and stuff like that. And you know, they just don't want to hear something that they don't want to hear. They want to shut it down. They'll say you're crazy, you're a lunatic, it's a fringe thing, whatever. But I think a lot of people really don't want to talk about it, because when you do start to talk about it, they really do understand, at least to some extent, Patricia, what's involved with getting, you know, the meat on the table. And one of the things that, you know, that I thought about as I was going through the process of not eating meat anymore was the fact that animals, like humans, they have fear. And they do understand when they're in a situation where it's not good for them. And that fear comes through. And so if they're going to the slaughterhouse, that animal is just filled with fear. And it's very, very, I'm talking about it right now, and it's just very disturbing when you think about it. And again, it's one of the reasons why I said, I can't do this anymore.
I was there too. I went, as I said, from being from an omnivore, I guess, to vegetarian, and then became the way I am now, vegan, very, very much so. And I won't say strict, because I have no desire for any of those things. Sometimes people say, oh, yeah, we'd get that pizza with cheese, but Patricia can't eat cheese. And I always say, it's not that I can't eat it. I literally could eat anything I wanted. I don't want to eat it. So it's a whole different thing. But the process of getting from vegetarian to vegan, to me, was kind of a weird one. I was on, I believe, Facebook, and it was New Year's Eve in the day. And I was, you know, on Facebook, just chatting with friends of mine. I was a regular Facebooker, not a flat earther, not a vegan, just a regular person in the matrix, I guess you could say. And somebody was talking about, what are you doing for New Year's Eve? And people were putting their comments into this post, what they're doing. And somebody said, I said, oh, I don't know. I might go out with my friends. And somebody else wrote, I'm going to have, chicken wings. I'm going to have hot wings. And somebody's like, I'm going to have pizza and a party. And then randomly out of the blue, this person who I didn't really know that well posted, well, do you know that what chicken wings are? They're part of the chicken who had to be killed for that. And I read that and went, yeah, I kind of know that. Who cares? But then this person posted a video, and I clicked the video, and my whole life changed. And the video was not just chickens being slaughtered. We know that's horrible. All of us do. I mean, if you stop and think about it, but this was something far different. This was, and by the way, at this point, I was vegetarian, thinking I was doing all I could for animals. This was a video of yellow, fluffy baby chicks on a conveyor belt, cheep, 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 piles of them, masses of them. You'd want to almost stroke them. They were so cute, just freshly hatched, on a conveyor belt with people wearing plastic gloves and surgical masks and uniforms, watching them go by, grabbing them, turning them to look to see what sex they were, and literally tossing these fragile little baby chicks into a meat grinder.
Oh, boy.
Where they were ground up alive. And I couldn't believe it. I thought, this is a lie. It's a fake video. So I started Googling and looked up lots of videos and read a lot about it. And what those workers were doing was they were sexing the chicks. The baby girl chicks are allowed to live because they will eventually lay eggs and be a productive part of the farm community. Until then, those chickens don't lay eggs anymore, and then they're slaughtered in the slaughterhouse and put into the grocery store, and then you have it on your table. But the boys, well, the boys are immediately killed, because the boys, you don't need them. You don't need to fertilize the egg to have eggs in the egg carton. And the boys don't make good food and, you know, chicken breasts, and they're killed. They are, they're a casualty of the farming industry in family farms and factory farms. They're just slaughtered. And that opened my eyes to the point where my eyes were filled with tears. I spent my New Year's Eve watching video after video, not just about the chickens, but about the cows.
Yeah.
And the dairy industry, where weirdly enough, the male cow, well, you guys get it rough in the animal industry. the cow, the new calf, excuse me, not baby cow. I'll use the correct word of calf. The calf, if it's male, is killed shipped off for veal, maybe kept in a crate, if that's the kind of farming practice, to for a little while, and then killed for veal immediately. But they don't want that. They don't want that bull. They don't want a male bull. You only need a few to fertilize the females. You don't need tons of them, but you need a lot of females. The females are the ones who produce the milk until they can't produce any more milk. And then they're taken to the slaughterhouse and they're killed and they wind up as hamburger on the plate. And it's even more devilish than that. When the baby calf, the boy is born, the mother, of course, loves it. And maybe people might say it's not like the love between a mother and child human. It's their kind of love. And you can see a bond is formed with animals. I mean, you talked about your dog, Charlie. In some countries, Charlie's dinner.
I know.
My three cats in some countries are dinner. But what's the difference between the unnamed boy calf and your dog, Charlie? It's just a decision we have made, ones to eat and ones to love. And that's an arbitrary decision because people love the taste of dog in some countries. And a lot of people are appalled to hear that. Oh, my God, how could they eat dog? Well, there's not much difference when you think about it. But what happens is they take the boy away and the boy's killed for veal, the calf. And the female cow, young little girl there, wants to nurse on her mother, on her udder, but she can't. Because guess what that milk's for? It's for the farmer to milk the cow and sell. So she's given a little colostrum so she can grow and then a formula made out of chemicals and powder and water. She drinks that and is ripped away from her mother after just a little bit of colostrum so that she can thrive. Without that, she'd die. And the mother cries for her baby like a human mother would. And in time, she soon forgets, different than a human. But there is that moment. And it could be even several hours of emotional pain at being separated from her child. So the calf, the baby girl goes off in some farms into a hut that looks like a doghouse, where there's hut after hut after hut, and they don't even connect with each other as young calves. And then eventually when they're old enough, they can be artificially inseminated from the bull semen, which is masturbated from one of the two bulls they have on the farm because they don't need that many. And the farmer literally rapes the female cow by sticking in a device with his arm into her vagina to inseminate the cow. They don't need to worry about the cows having sex for procreation to create new cows. It's much easier to have one or two bulls and to do it manually. And they have a thing that the farmers often refer to as the quote rape rack that they put the female cow up on to do this device where they artificially inseminate her. And people will say it's not rape. But the thing is that cow doesn't want that to happen. I've seen the videos. It's struggling. It's scared. It's probably painful. This is the society that we have where we found a very expedient way to get as much out of the cow as we can. And the reason that the cow needs to have this done is not just to produce the calf, the boy for the veal and the female to be a future milker. It's so the cow herself will give milk. Because just like humans, mammals only produce milk from their udders or their breasts when they are post-pregnancy. So the female cow in most of the farms, the factory farms, which are most farms, by the way, most people think, oh, no, I don't buy from factory farms. You do. You just don't know it for the most part. They're hidden with happy signs and labels put on products that make us not think. I mean, if you look at a carton of eggs, there might be a little picture of a grass and a chicken pecking the ground. But the reality is far from that. Anyway, so, yeah, she's got to give milk. And her milk years are only a small period of time, just like a human female. Her years of childbirth are only a small period of time. And then when she reaches menopause, when the cow reaches cowopause, whatever it is, she can no longer bear children. And at that point, she can no longer give milk. And at that point, that's when she goes to the slaughterhouse too. There's no rest. I think if I had a choice to be born the male calf or the female, I'd pick male. At least you go to the slaughterhouse right away and get killed. Your whole life as a female calf to cow is one of slavery. And it's not that happy cow on the farm. Yes, some of them do eat grass grass-fed cow? Yes, of course they do. Some eat organic diets, but in the end, they are our slaves, unwillingly. It gives them no pleasure to give milk, and they only make that milk for one reason, for the babies. And we steal it from them, and their babies drink an artificial substance.
Well, it's very important to talk about this, Patricia, even though I know a lot of people are probably getting uncomfortable with this. But this is the reality of the situation. I think it's important to put it out on the table. And if anybody doubts what it is that Patricia is taking us through, or even some of the stuff that I mentioned earlier, it's not hard to find the information, the documentaries that you had mentioned, Patricia. I'll put them in the show notes with this show so anybody who is interested can take a look. But this is how it works. It's part of the awakening for me that has to do with doing the right thing with everything, and that includes animals.
I can hear in your voice right now how sincere you are. I can hear, and it's a beautiful thing. I feel the same way. For me, it's part of the awakening. Other people are resentful of me even saying that, and I've heard it said that you don't need to be vegan or vegetarian to be awake. I'm not saying that. I'm saying for me and for you, it is a part of the awakening to see what we do to animals, that if it were done to us, it would be a crime.
Right. That's right. And the thing is, some folks will say, or maybe they even thought that being a vegan was just something that you decided to do. It was kind of a fad type of thing. And the point I'm trying to make, folks, is that, yes, there's going to be some folks that are going to follow suit because their friend or family member became a vegan, and they were talking about the benefits of being having a vegan diet, as an example. But then there are going to be those folks that made the switch because of exactly what Patricia just took us mm-hmm. through.
Yes.
Okay. So, and it's important, again, it's important to understand that piece of it. You cannot put your head in the sand and pretend and make believe that that doesn't go on.
Now that we've got all the nasty stuff out of the way.
Yes. I remember in the beginning of the show, I said that wasn't going to be heavy, but that part was heavy.
Yes.
And, but
mm-hmm.
you know what? It was necessary.
Yes. And for more information, the videos that I'd mentioned, the movies that I mentioned, documentaries, as you said, you'll put them in the show notes. But there's a YouTube channel. There's a guy whose name is Gary Yourofsky. And you spell his last name Y-O-U-R, your, and then O-F of Sky, S-K-Y, Gary Yor of Sky, but it's pronounced Gary Yourofsky. And he's got a video out, and it's got the gory stuff in it, but it's also got some real hard truths, or what they call home truths, in it. And his video is a definite must-see. You can find it on YouTube under a couple of different names, but they're all about the same. He lectured all over the world between 2002 and 2014 about veganism. And the video you can find on YouTube is called, The Best Speech Ever, or the newest revised Best Speech Ever video. And it's a lecture with, students there, and they're listening to this man on stage talking about veganism, and then he goes to a film and shows a little bit of the gore, but then gets back to the explanations. And I think that's a very, very good one for people to look at. But Gary Yourofsky also does all sorts of other videos on his channel, Gary Yourofsky. The videos are, you know, how to be vegan and on a budget, vegan junk food, and it's not all doom and gloom, as I said when we started. And I think that there's, aside from the horrendous basic animal holocaust that is going on night and day all over the world, there's also the health aspect. And like I said, I'm vegan for the animals. That's my number one concern. But once you understand that there may be a reason to stop eating meat, dairy, and eggs, and fish for the animal's sake, then you might move into the health part. But some people get to it from the health part first, which I think is fantastic. There are a number of famous athletes who have decided to switch their diet to being a vegan diet. And some of these people at the date of this recording are vegan. And you know how celebrities are. Vegan today, tomorrow they're on the all-steak diet. But as of January 15, 2018, we've got Venus Williams, She adopted a raw vegan diet. She was diagnosed with a disease called Sjögren's syndrome, and I can't even spell that, but S-J-O-G-R-E-N-S syndrome, and then I can't even say that. But some may know what it is, in 2011, and they said, her doctor said, well, the joint pain that you are feeling with this disease may go away if you adopt a raw vegan diet. And this syndrome, however you pronounce it, is an autoimmune disorder. And she says that she fell in love with fueling her body with a raw food diet. She feels it's helped her on the court and how to feel better and look better. So that's one famous person who's gone vegan. Another one is Lewis Hamilton, a Formula One racing driver. And another one is Scott Jurek, long distance runner. Some of these people you may know or may not know. Jermaine Defoe, a footballer. He plays for Bournemouth FC and the England national team as a striker. He said, I don't find anything hard to give up with giving up meat, dairy, and eggs because I know the feeling that scoring more goals gives me. So he feels it's helped his performance. David Hay, a boxer, totally muscular with, I don't know, I think he's got an 8-pack more than a 6-pack. He's a British boxer. He's got titles in 2 weight categories and he's won boxing championships. And as of the date of this recording, he's been vegan about 4 years. Another bodybuilder named Barney Duplessis has a book on being vegan. He was a Mr. Universe in 2014. A lot of people think vegans can't make muscles, but it is completely untrue. Hannah Teeter, a very pretty blonde female snowboarder, 3-time Olympic medalist, is a vegan. Also a guy named Kendrick Jacob Ferris, a weightlifter, and Tia Blanco, another gorgeous woman, a surfer. A mixed martial artist named Nate Diaz is a vegan. Megan Duhamel, one of the pair skaters, a 4-time Olympic medalist pair skater champion, is also vegan. Timothy Schieff, S-H-I-E-F-F, who is a free runner. And also, not only is he a vegan, he's a flat earther. He's got a channel as well. You can just look up the words Timothy Schieff on YouTube and you can find his channel. So he's kind of a double barrel threat, kind of like me. Jack Lindquist, a track cyclist, is also vegan. Another guy named Abel Trulio, a mixed martial artist, is also vegan. And oh my gosh, we could go on and on and on with famous and not famous vegan athletes proving that they have very fit bodies and sharp minds and actually good looks. They look good too. And they purport to feel really good. And that's just one way to look at veganism from a very positive way, that you can be strong with great performance and also fuel yourself with plant-based foods.
I know a lot of naturopaths and integrative medicine doctors, Patricia, with clients that have autoimmune disorders like arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis as an example, are moving them to vegan diets because the vegan diet is showing that it will reduce the inflammation and many of the symptoms of these autoimmune diseases. So there's a lot of traction behind
it's
that
growing.
These days.
It is growing. Veganism puts your body in its more natural alkaline state as opposed to an acidic state. Animals that are true omnivores, and I know people believe we're omnivores. Yeah, we can be an omnivore and eat whatever we want, but that doesn't mean that's what our body was created to eat. So, you know, just because you can do something doesn't mean you should. You can look at that with robbing banks or anything else, but true carnivores in the animal kingdom and true omnivores have a higher percentage of acid in their stomach in order to break down the bones and all the other things when they eat that animal whole. Their amount of stomach acid is between 4 and 5. And people who are what we probably are, which would be an herbivore or a frugivore, have much less acid in our stomach. And so having an acid body is bad for human beings. And an acid body does cause inflammation, which is at the root of so many diseases, like you said.
Well, plus cancer thrives in acidic Bodies, yep. That's one of the things I've been doing some research on with regard to cancer. And if you have cancer, or if you want to prevent getting cancer, one of the things that you can do is move your body to an alkaline state.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And that's fruits and vegetables. I mean, and like you are doing, fish is a much better option. I'm not here to condemn people, least of all you, for eating fish. I went that way as well. I, you know, get, you know, was still holding on to sushi for a while. And then, you know, went all the way. But, the worst thing you can eat is definitely not even meat. It's dairy. Dairy is really pretty much liquid meat, but even more toxic. And a lot of people grew up with the thought, like I had said earlier, about dairy being good for you. It's not good for you. It's completely, in fact, bad for you. And if you give these things up, you will be rewarded. It's almost like, this is a crazy thought, that the animals are punishing us for torturing and killing them by giving us all of these diseases and horrible things that aren't quite diseases but aren't so good. If you become vegan, you will eventually see, if you have bad skin, skin improvement, less lines on your face, a more fresh look. Definitely, if you're younger and in the acne years, less pimples, acne, rashes will decrease. You'll have stronger hair and rapid hair growth. Your nails as well, since they're basically made out of the same thing. People who watch me on YouTube have marveled. I started with quite short hair and got lots of haircuts. But my hair now is getting pretty long. A lot of people say to me, I can't grow my hair like that. And I'm not saying my hair grows like it does and my nails are quite long and strong due to veganism. But you know what? I do think that there is a component. I'm feeding my body the nutrition that it needs and my body's rewarding me. I have very healthy teeth. I've had two cavities in my life. I have all of my own natural teeth. I got braces when I was young because they were a bit crooked. A lot of people have reported healthier teeth, less plaque and gingivitis buildup, and stronger bones. Now, people feel, because we've been told, you need calcium, especially women. That is pushed. When you reach menopause, they make you take calcium pills, tablets, because they are afraid that your bone density will be lost as you age, and then you'll break a hip when you're older, like many older women do. But the thing is that milk and dairy leach calcium from our bones. It's far better to get it from plants, spinach and broccoli and kale and the like. They have more protein pound for pound than milk does, for sure. Good breath as well is another function. Part of the, you know, the teeth and the mouth thing I was talking about. Good breath, because your stomach is not in the process of digesting a carcass or secretion from a carcass, gross as that may sound. It's quickly digesting plants, and we've got a shorter colon than a real true carnivore does. Excuse me, we've got a longer colon than a carnivore does. A carnivore, like a cat, like my cats, or a lion, let's say, they've got a very, very short colon to evacuate that meat and from their body immediately. Well, we humans have quite a long colon. If you've ever had a colonoscopy, they got to knock you out. It's a very long circuitous route. There's the large and small colon. We're not meant to have that meat fermenting in our stomachs like that. And when we do, it produces things like colon cancer. We get polyps. We get hemorrhoids. And when you go on a vegan diet, I'm not going to recommend never get a colonoscopy again, but just between you and me, I've had one, not a single polyp. And after that, I said, why am I even getting these? I'm not going to get colon cancer. I'm vegan. I eat so many plants that it's insane. So you will have benefits. But the biggest benefit of all, in my opinion anyway, is not just physical and the longer life and the lack of disease and the stronger hair and the clearer skin. It's that feeling that you are to the best possible level doing no harm to your fellow creatures. It's a peace of mind.
I have a story real quick, Patricia. You mentioned about the dental health, and I went to the dentist, I guess about 2 months ago, a new dentist. And while I was in the chair, the hygienist said to me, you don't eat meat, do you?
Ooh, interesting.
And I looked at her and I said, well, no, I don't. I said, how did you know that? And she said, because we have found that our patients or clients that do not eat meat, their teeth are healthier. They don't have all that plaque. And she said it was very obvious.
Wow.
That those that do not eat meat, they have healthier teeth.
I've never heard that before specifically from a dentist, but I think that's wonderful. That's wonderful information. The benefits will not be coming to you if you've already got great teeth, or you've already got great skin or great hair or smooth digestion. If you've got those things and you become vegan, you may not have those benefits. You might not have weight loss if you're a vegan, if you become vegan, if you're already thin. I didn't have weight loss. I'm already thin. But the peace of mind aspect is such a benefit to me. I feel happier and lighter. There is the darker component when you know the torture that's going on 24 hours a day. You do know that. And like you said, when you see the truck going to the slaughterhouse with the cages full of the squealing pigs, how it can break your heart once you're vegan, you become very sensitive. This sounds really crazy and wimpy, but when I go to the grocery store, I avoid the meat section. To me, it is a mortuary. These are corpses of my friends. And I know many will laugh at that, but if I have to walk by to get somewhere else, I close my eyes. I know it sounds crazy, but I don't want to see that. I used to love cheese, but when I walk by the section in a very nice grocery store, like in America, we've got Whole Foods. They have these big wheels of cheese, beautiful displays, very high end cheeses. The smell is the most revolting, disgusting thing ever. And I used to eat the stinkiest of cheeses with relish, fine cheese plates. That was my thing. But no more. Now it's like my senses have, and my soul has been cleaned, or cleansed is a better word usage, of these programming things where I can see more clearly what animals are and what real nutritious food for my body is.
It really is a process though, Patricia, right? Like myself, I'm not where you're at yet, but I'm making, you know, strides to get there. But I found like when I first started, I was like you. I was eating the, you know, the typical American diet, cheeses, meat, hamburgers, all that stuff. And then several years ago, I switched to organic food. I was still eating the meat and all that stuff, but I switched to organic. And what I found was my health improved considerably. So let me just take the audience through this a little bit. Some folks, and I had this too, you'd be at work and it'd be 2 o'clock in the afternoon or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And all of a sudden you feel like you hit a wall and you're dragging. You feel fatigued and tired. And so when I changed the diet and I got away from all the processed foods and all the GMO foods and I went organic, that fatigue and all that, it subsided, went away. And I had a lot more zip in my step and I didn't get that tired feeling, that fatigued feeling at 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. That went away. And then what we're saying is then you move to the next step on the ladder, then the next step and the next step. And because it is really a process.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's and I know I'm going through that process myself, because like I said before, folks, if I can do it, anybody could do it. But it is a process. And I want to reiterate that because it does take time for many folks to make their way down the path.
Oh, yeah. I say that on that New Year's Eve I spoke about earlier, I went vegan overnight, but I was already vegetarian. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's not like I was just eating a steak one day and said, no more of this. I remember prior to going vegan, my brother, who he has a girlfriend now, but at the time was talking about a woman that we both knew. And I said, and he was like, what do you think of her? And I said, oh, I think she's really nice and smart, but you know, she's vegan. That's kind of weird. I remember saying it to my brother, kind of telling her not to date her because it's weird. Being vegan's weird. That's because I didn't really know what it was. I thought it was hippies. Nothing wrong with hippies, by the way. But that's where my mind was. It's kind of like hippies who were like sitting around in like a yurt with a hemp shirt and they're dirty. And I just had this idea, and I'm sorry if I'm insulting anybody who has a yurt they live in, whatever that may be. But what I mean is I had this idea. It's a bunch of weird cultish people. When really a vegan is a normal person. I'm a normal person, a normal woman who, when you meet me, I do those normal person things. Like, I don't know. I wear makeup. I'm a vegan. I get my hair styled, but I'm vegan. Now, my makeup's all vegan, of course, and shampoo, conditioner. Oh my gosh, everything in my house, cleaning products is all vegan. But I still do those normal things. I get my nails done. Maybe that's not normal for some people, but I'm talking about people that are in the matrix. I still can kind of have parts of my living in the matrix lifestyle if I so choose, but I do it the vegan way. You can veganize anything, almost anything in your life by choosing the vegan option instead. You need a new duvet for your bed. Don't buy the goose down one because those are plucked from those poor geese while they're still alive and struggling to get away. Why do that to animals when you can buy a poly one that will have beautiful loft and keep you warm in the winter and cool in the summer and pillows that are beautiful and fluffy if you buy the right kind, not some lumpy ones from the cheapest store possible. They don't have to be goose down. You can have jackets. I have faux fur jackets. I mean, I like fashion, so I have lots of different clothes. I used to own a clothing store. I have faux leather shoes, faux leather handbags. I, at this point, own zero leather or silk items, or I have never had any fur to begin with items, real fur anyway. I have none of that in my closet. And so I am not holier than thou at all, compared to a vegan who still wears their dad's leather jacket they inherited or whatever, or they still wear their leather shoes because they're good and they don't want to throw it out. I just made a personal decision to rid myself of all of those things. I don't use any animal beauty products that are either have animal ingredients or that are tested on animals, and even more so that are owned by a parent company who has animal testing going on, et cetera, et cetera. A lot of cosmetic companies are ultimately owned, even if it's like Joe's Organic Makeup, then it's owned by Estee Lauder, who does horrible, horrible animal testing in rabbits' eyes and cutting open the skull of cats and inserting drugs into them to test things. Just crazy. When we have computers that can model all of these things, we don't need to abuse animals to test things. We just don't. And hasn't there already been enough testing already? Don't we know that, you know, you don't put, you know, battery acid in your eye, so we don't need to test it on animals first? It's ridiculous what we do. And the laws that allow these things to stay in place really need to be overturned.
Yeah, I agree. I agree, Patricia, 100%. Now, let me ask you this, because some folks may not know this, but what's the difference between a vegan and a vegetarian?
Oh, yeah, I probably should have cleared that up. I'm talking as an insider to the point where I guess I'm not giving the right info. Okay, well, a vegetarian, there's different forms. There's a lacto-ovo, which is one who eats dairy, lacto, an ovo, ovum, which is the egg. And there's a pescatarian, like yourself. A pescatarian may or may not eat the eggs of an animal still and the dairy of an animal still. But vegetarian can be a person who eats fish and eggs and dairy, or one of those, or three of those, or two of those, or whatever. But a vegan is no animal products whatsoever. And if you were a hardcore vegan, you would say that that includes no honey and no use of animals to wear, as we had just discussed, or for products in your home like down comforters. And even a step further, you don't attend things like rodeos where animals are ridden, bulls are, you know, used in the ring. You don't ride horses even. You don't attend things like SeaWorld where they have the, you know, the killer whales kept in captivity, or the or sharks or dolphins. You don't go fishing, even if you throw the fish back. You don't use animals for entertainment purposes, for food purposes, for clothing purposes, or for health and beauty purposes. You just let animals live. You don't use them as your slaves. That's the kind of vegan I am. And as I said, I've maybe 10 times so far, I don't look down on anybody who is not there yet at all, or thinks all of this is crazy, because trust me, I was there.
Yeah. Now let me ask you this then. The vegan diets, are there different versions of veganism? You mentioned raw vegan diet before. So other than a raw vegan diet, are there other types of vegan diets?
Well, the thing is that I was saying that I'm kind of like a level 11 vegan in the way I deal with not using any animals whatsoever. And there's nothing animal in my house except my cats. When it comes to the level of veganism, I would say the highest level would be considered a fruitarian, which I'm not, although I go a day or two sometimes just eating fruit if I feel like it. And here's why: a fruitarian isn't even killing plants. They are only eating fruits that naturally fall from a tree. The tree itself or the plant doesn't have to die and will continue to bear fruit no matter how many are taken off of it. So, and they do say that perhaps our natural diet is that of a frugivore, the way our teeth are constructed and our colon is constructed. And I would like to be a frugivore, but I enjoy the foods that I eat too much to do that. However, if I ever came down with a horrible disease, I would become a fruitarian immediately to cleanse my body. And if I ever feel sick, and by the way, I rarely ever get sick. And I do have to add that I never will come down with a horrible disease. This is the mindset I want to keep myself in. And I think we all should say that sort of thing. Not if it happens, because it won't happen. But if I ever got sick, a cold or something, and I haven't had one of those for, I can't even remember the last time, 10 years almost, I would go immediately on an all fruit diet. And even if you're not vegan or vegetarian, probably a good idea. If you ever get really sick, just go all fruit for a couple of days. That'll help your body cleanse. It'll be very light on your digestive system, so your body can focus its energies on actually healing you of the toxic stuff that's causing you to be sick. So fruitarian would be probably the highest rank. And below that would be raw. Raw would be just eating raw foods, not cooking them, because cooking does compromise some of the nutrients. And it's one of those things that, yeah, I'm raw every once in a while. I don't plan to be, but I've just had a salad and some fruit that day. I haven't eaten any cooked foods, no grains, no beans, etc. Yes, I guess that would be ideal too, but I love warm cooked food. I had oatmeal earlier today. I love oatmeal. It's comforting, you know? So it's not the kind of vegan I am, although I do dabble in fruitarianism and raw often. Those, I think, are very good things to go to if you're so inclined or if you get sick. But I don't think that any vegan should look down upon other vegans like, oh, well, I'm a fruitarian and you're just a vegan over there eating your cooked beans. You know, we should never look down on people who eat, if you're vegan, who eat steak or cheese or anything. We all should realize we all are at different stages of awakening. And some of us feel we're totally awake well enough. And like in the movie The Matrix, we want to eat that Matrix steak, even if we feel we're awake. And I say, hey, more power to you. Educate yourself. Learn about all of the stuff that we've been talking about. Then decide. Don't just shut it down because it's not what you're familiar and comfortable with, because that's when we cease learning. And when you cease learning, you cease living.
Now, I went to the web, Patricia, in preparation for the show just to get some facts, I guess we can call them facts, about the benefits of a vegan diet. So this is what I came across, and I'll read them off. It's only about maybe 8 to 10 here. Then I'd like to get your perspective. So lower BMI, body mass, improved gut health, higher intake of antioxidants, lower blood pressure, improved kidney function, protects against certain cancers, breast cancer, prostate and colon is what was mentioned in the one website I went to, lower risk of heart disease, rich in vitamins A, C, and E, and more fiber and, again, I mentioned this before, antioxidants. So there's a lot of really good things that go along with a vegan diet. And I will talk a little bit about some of the criticisms too. But first, I want to get your take on the benefits, the things that I mentioned. Are these things that you realized yourself or...
Oh, yes.
Let you know? Yeah, okay.
Well, for me, I never had a high BMI and I've never had any diseases. I have slightly low blood pressure naturally and my cholesterol as well is low. I've never been on any pharmaceutical drugs except for, you know, when you have, I had to have my appendix out randomly at one point in my life and I had to have antibiotics. And I'm definitely for doctors, for emergency medicine. I'm all for it. And I'm all for something like an antibiotic in those emergency cases, only very, very limited use. But other than that, I don't go to the doctor. I will occasionally go, that's not entirely true, to get a blood workup if I want to feel good about myself, because I get this blood test results that are just so stupendous that it makes me feel, yeah, I am doing the right thing. My protein levels are bang on. All of the different, you know, sorts of things one would look for are perfect. I'm not suffering in any way with the vegan diet, not in the way I look definitely not in the way I feel. I wake up, I spring out of bed at 7 a.m. every morning without an alarm clock, for the most part. I mean, you know, there are those days you feel like sleeping in. I always have energy. I don't have that mid-afternoon slump crash that I used to have. And I don't have cravings for junk food, or, you know, I mean the junk food like McDonald's and Coca-Cola and whatever else. To me, those things sound disgusting. I like a little bit of vegan junk food every now and again, but you know, I'm not a slave to eating tofu. I don't really eat fake meat products. Some of them are fairly good. I generally don't eat fake meats, but they're a very good stopgap measure if you first go vegan and you want that familiar taste and texture. But yeah, though, what you mentioned as health benefits are, you know, and what some of the ones we mentioned before are totally spot on. And the fact that if you're on pharmaceutical drugs now for something that you may have, like multiple sclerosis or Crohn's disease or something, you will, through veganism, I would say in a month or two, be able to throw away those drugs and not be on them anymore. If you've had a double bypass operation or a stent put in your heart, well, how that actually happened to you is you ate the wrong food, sad to say. It wasn't just bad luck of the draw or genetics or something. And if you say, well, my father had a heart attack too, probably he was eating the same diet as you. You grew up in the same house. You will not have to face the same fate your father did if your father died of a heart attack when he was 45. If you stop now, and you won't have to take those pharmaceutical drugs. And the thing about taking drugs for diseases, you will have side effects from those drugs. And those side effects will attack another organ in your body, which will then start to fail, like your kidneys or your liver. So you'll find yourself taking a cornucopia of pharmaceuticals to help each side effect. And in the end, your organs will start to fail. When instead of having multiple operations and spending all of that money going to the doctor and taking all of these drugs and feeding this horrible industry, pharmaceutical industry, and by urinating into our water system, you're putting those drugs right into fish and all of the animals and all of the plants. So instead of having that lifestyle, have a lifestyle which will minimize all of this horror for yourself and the animals and the rest of the humans. It's easy, and it's actually less expensive. My grocery bill is less expensive than when I was buying meat, dairy, and eggs.
Yeah, a lot of folks, they just don't understand that the pharmaceuticals are nothing more than chemicals being pumped into your body. And you're absolutely right, Patricia. The side effects of the pharmaceutical drugs are just, they're mind-boggling. And the thing is, most people do not read the inserts with these drugs. So they just take them, and they take, you know, on the advice of their doctor to take the drugs. Now, if something serious happens to you medically, that if you need to take a pharmaceutical drug as an intervention, you've got to do what you've got to do. But where I'm coming from with this, Patricia, is that, and I think it's where you're at with it, is you get on the vegan diet or you get on a much healthier diet, then the chances or the probability that you're going to wind up having medical disorders and diseases is going to diminish significantly. So your trips to the doctor are going to become fewer and fewer. That's where you want to be. You want to be on a road where you are eating very, very healthy, because what you take into your body, that's the fuel, mm-hmm. you know? And if your body is taking in chemicals and doesn't know what to do with it, then your body's expending energy on the process of trying to figure out what to do with what you put in your body. And that's what causes bodies to break down, the mind to break down, or the mind-body dynamic to break down. I guess my point being is that you want to be on that healthy road, because you will go to the doctor a lot less, if ever, if you're really healthy. I do want to also say that we're not advocating that you abandon any kind of medical attention if it's required.
Right, exactly. I mean, you know, we are not doctors, nor do we play them on TV.
No, exactly, right. Because some people might take it at face value and say, well, I'm just going to go do this and everything will be okay. You know, you have to use your common sense, folks, that if you have something going on, you get it checked out. And then you can make the move. Like we've been talking through this whole show, that this is a process. It's mm-hmm. it's incremental for many, many, many people. Some folks can make the switch like that, light switches on, light switches off. But for many folks, myself included, It is a process. So,
yes.
Let me ask this question now, Patricia, because there are going to be folks who are listening to this show and they're going to think that we're two weirdos.
We are. But and, don't you love it?
yeah, we are. And they're going to say, hey, look, you know, I've been reading a lot of stuff on this vegan stuff and on the internet and the web and so on. And there are problems with this diet. So I'm going to read off some of the things here that I found where they were cautioning about an all-vegan diet. So I'll read them off and then you can, you know, just take us through this. You run the risk of protein deficiency, lower levels of...
Can I make that noise that they do on those game shows? With a big red X.
Okay.
All right.
That's okay. So we got a big X on that one. Lower levels of B12, lower levels of zinc, higher intake of what they refer to as anti-nutrients, which contain trispin inhibitors, which can inhibit the digesting of calcium, magnesium, and iron, inability to put on muscle. They say that the vitamins that you need for muscle building and muscle mass comes from meat and fish. So they're talking about vitamin D.
Ask a gorilla about that. They eat plants and look how big they are.
So good point.
Another red X.
All right. So they're talking about, of course, vitamin D, omega-3 fats and fish oil and B vitamins. Overconsumption of carbohydrates, which can lead to candida and yeast overgrowth. And last but not least, at least on my list of things, fatigue and feeling exhausted. And that's because of the deficiency of B vitamins, they're saying.
Well,
so where do you want to start?
Well, I'll go with the B vitamin thing first, because that is the only thing on that list that has any validity. I'm shaking this bottle here. This is a bottle of methylcobalamin. I'll spell it. C-O-B-A-L-A-M-I-N. It's a tiny little, less than a woman's, half of a woman's little finger nail pill. And it's a sublingual tablet, 5 milligrams of this dietary supplement. It is vitamin B12. Vitamin B12, this little bottle with 120 tablets in it, I've had for 3 years. And you can tell quite a lot still in here. 120 tablets. I take one every, I don't know, 4 months. I see it and I'm like, oh yeah, I grabbed it today because I'm like, this is your only argument against veganism. One of these every couple of months. I get my B12 tested when I go do a blood test at the doctor's, and it's always higher than meat eaters. And the thing about B12 is they say it's only found in meat. Yes and no. It's a process by which the, let's just use a cow, for example, eats things on the ground, plants, let's say grass or something, and there's dirt on it. That's where the B12 comes in. Then it goes into the cow and the cow is digesting it and that becomes part of the cow's flesh. Well, you literally could get enough B12 probably from eating some unwashed carrots. It's basically that dirt and what's in that dirt, a microscopic amount. So if you're worried about it, and I was never worried about it for years till I saw those same, oh, you're going to die without the B12. I bought the B12. I rarely take it. When it comes to the energy, I have boundless energy. I'm 55 years old, and I'd say everyone who's ever met me would say, you don't look 55. What's your secret? And I'm not going to say it's veganism. Some of it is genetics. Some of it's my attitude. Some of it's good luck. And then again, I don't look perfect either. Who does? When it comes to zinc, you can get zinc in your diet. Many people who eat meat, by the way, take multivitamins. It's a huge industry. And if you are going to be vegan and taking any vitamins, make sure they're vegan vitamins. You can put a Google search on that, because sometimes they use gelatin, which is the hoof of a horse or a cow that's in the capsules. There's also plant gelatin too, so you can do your research on that. But you can get zinc from legumes, nuts, seeds, and oatmeal. Natural foods that are part of a vegan diet. Brazil nuts, tons of zinc. It's not a problem. You just have to know what you're doing. But I remember growing up in the 70s, and my mother put together what was called then a balanced diet. She knew she had to plan it. You have to plan that too when you're eating, unless you're just going to go to McDonald's and say, I'll have the, you know, special number one. You've got to plan your diet regardless of if you eat meat and dairy or not, you're going to say, well, I need some citrus fruits. I don't want to get scurvy. I'm going to need some protein. I mean, you know, I need some grains for energy. We all plan our diet. So if one's to say, oh, it's just too hard to plan your diet, we're all doing it anyway with each choice we make when it comes to food. So those things are, I would say, scare tactics. And sometimes I believe those sorts of surveys are in a sort of backroom way funded by the meat and dairy industry or egg industry.
Oh, could very well be. How about the protein deficiency? What do you do for protein then?
Well, the amount of protein that is in vegetables is amazing. I don't supplement with protein, although there are vegan protein powders. I don't ever take those. I've never had low levels of protein. When I've had my blood test done, it's a normal high level of protein. So all you need to do is eat a wide array of plants. You don't need to even plan it that well, like make a flow chart or PowerPoint presentation. You will find protein in, buckwheat, for example, buckwheat noodles. You go get some Thai food, you got your buckwheat noodles, 6 grams of protein per cup. Rice and beans, perfect protein. Hummus, I love hummus, one of my favorite things. Eat some hummus and pita, protein done. There's so many types of proteins that you can eat. There's protein in broccoli. Believe it or not, look it up. People think that vegans are skinny, gangly, weak, sick, pale people. Now, I am pale. I'm a natural redhead with green eyes, but that has nothing to do with being vegan. Hemp is a great source of protein too. You can get lots of different sorts of cereal, or you can get hemp powder and throw it in a smoothie, throw it on top of your oatmeal or something, and you'll get 11 grams of protein just like that. Non-dairy milks have protein. I mean, almond milk, soy milk. Some people don't want soy. No one's forcing you to eat soy. And I make sure to buy organic soy when I buy soy milk. And there is still organic soy, by the way. But you have to look. If you like tofu, speaking of soy, you got your protein there. But like I said, you don't want soy, don't eat tofu. There's tempeh. One cup of tempeh packs about 30 grams of protein. And there's also sprouted grain breads. I buy this brand called Ezekiel. You can get it at Whole Foods. It's delicious. It's not just grain bread. It's sprouted. And when it's sprouted, it's easier to digest and the protein is readily available. And there's only like 4 or 5 ingredients in it. And all of them, you know, different grains and salt and water or something. But Ezekiel bread, I get it at Whole Foods, and they've got flax bread and all of these things are, I know the things I buy, I routinely buy the same things when I go to the grocery store. I get my cart like everyone else and then go to this section and that section and get these things I always get. But everyone does that. It's not monotonous or boring, because even if you eat meat, dairy, eggs, and fish, you are always pretty much buying generally the same things every week. That's how it always is.
You know, changing your diet is really not that hard. I mentioned earlier in the show that the actual deciding whether to do it is more difficult than actually doing it. I found that for me, for changing my diet, once I threw the switch, I just did it. It wasn't really that difficult. In fact, I would think to myself afterwards, Patricia, that really wasn't that hard.
No.
You know, I mean, in your head, you're thinking, oh, I don't know. I really like this. I really like that. What am I going to do if I go to a restaurant? Or what am I going to do when I go to a family get together? And all that stuff just kind of goes away, because once you get there, you're like, well, I can eat this, this, and that. And, you know, you just make some choices and that's what you do.
You're slim and healthy. I've seen you in real life, not just on YouTube. I'm slim and healthy. You've seen me in real life. Neither one of us looks like our hair's falling out, or we just look like very healthy human beings. And we are doing good for our body. We're on different stages of development in that. I mean, I could go farther and become a fruitarian if I wanted to, or, you know, you could do other things as well if you wanted to. But right now you've made a major life change, and I really applaud you for that. But you and I both know David Weiss, right?
Yeah, yep.
DITRH, deep inside the rabbit hole.
David's a good friend. Yep.
He's wonderful. he and I joke around all of the time about, you know, he's just a joker. And one of the things he says is, about veganism, because he's not vegan, but he and Paige, his significant other, are often, you know, aside from joking with me about them being vegan, me being vegan and them not being vegan, they do, you know, definitely push toward that. And he knew I was going to be talking to you today, and he said this to me before. He said, remember, you don't have to be a vegan to eat a vegan meal. And it's true. We all eat vegan meals, even if we're not vegan all the time. Everyone's grabbed a salad before that didn't have any meat or dairy in it. We've all eaten vegan meals and we didn't die. And it's not hard.
Hey, Patricia, what advice do you have for somebody considering a vegan diet? I mean, is there anything they need to know before they get started? I mean, do they just jump into it, or are there any precautionary measures that they should consider before going vegan?
No, I think the number one thing that you need to have is, if you're deciding to do it for the animals, have an open heart. And if you're deciding to do it for your body and your body alone, have an open mind. And go forward and do a tiny bit of research. I think a good source would be a doctor, an actual medical doctor, not a witch doctor. His name is Dr. Greger, G-R-E-G-O-R. You can find him on YouTube at nutritionfacts.org. That's also a website, but it's his YouTube channel, nutritionfacts.org. He's a really wonderful, warm, and affable guy. He sometimes does live videos walking on a treadmill at the same time as he's talking about all sorts of different facts about health. Does garlic do X, Y, and Z? What happens to your body when you eat pork? I mean, very interesting. Even if you're not vegan, it's a very interesting channel to go check out. So nutritionfacts.org, Dr. Greger. He is vegan, but he talks about the science of it all. So if you're one of those kind of people that wants to know the science, instead of going and finding one of those debunking veganism websites that you can find everywhere, because you can debunk everything. I mean, you can probably go online right now and find a website or a video that says, we're all dead, we're not alive. Seriously, because you can find everything and debunk everything, even the fact that we're alive, by going on YouTube or Googling it. It's just the way it all is. There's so much information out of there and a lot of disinfo. But Dr. Greger provides very solid, scientific, mainstream information. And it's a very, very wonderful channel to check out. So that's one of those things where you're going to use your mind, and using your heart would be, if you need some impetus to stay vegan when people are eating cheese pizza, it's those videos that I mentioned, those documentaries, the one that you saw and the others we talked about that you're going to put in the description of this video, that you need to see and keep the picture in mind of the cow and the baby and the pig. You know, pigs are as intelligent as or more so than a 3-year-old child. And I know you see comments from people when you're vegan, like, bacon, or, you know, there's a bacon mania that swept across the United States. But bacon is the flesh of an animal as intelligent as a 3-year-old child who didn't want to die, to be fried in a pan, eaten by you, and pooped into a toilet a few hours later. Its life is more valuable than that.
Yeah, that's the, we're circling back to what you and I spoke about earlier, is that when you put it into the context, Patricia, of living sentient beings, animals, I mean, that's what they are. And that's what got me. Like I said, I watched, I'll find that video. I mean, it was rough, but it was good that it was rough, because it got right to the point, and I probably got about 15 minutes into it, and I said to myself, okay, eating meat is done. It's over. I can't do this anymore. It was very difficult to watch.
Eating meat is so 2017. You know, the GMO issue is another thing. I've heard some criticism, very small amount of very vocal YouTubers have actually attacked vegans and have said that veganism is part of the New World Order Agenda 21. And I literally had to do that, if you're old enough to remember a commercial for V8 vegetable juice where the person smacks their head and says, I could have had a V8. I had to do that head smack. Like, what?
Yeah.
veganism is promoting the New World Order Agenda 21? And I had to think about it, and I'm like, what are you talking about? And they said, well, vegans want people to stop eating meat and dairy and eggs and fish and make us eat GMO crops, GMO tofu and soy products and fake meats and GMO grains. And my response to that is, did you know that well over 95% of the milk, meat, and eggs on the U.S. market today come from animals that have consumed genetically modified foods? So the animals that you're eating ate GMOs. Therefore, you're eating GMOs.
They feed them GMO food.
Yes, they do.
There's a documentary on that, too. The animals, when they're given the GMO feed, they don't like to eat it. They know it's artificial. They know there's something not right with that food, and they give it to the animals anyway.
Just like the animals know that they're going to the slaughterhouse, not the way you and I would,
right,
but the fear that's coursing through their bodies. Yeah. They see their fellow animal, I'm going to anthropomorphize when I say friends, but the ones that they've seen with them for years or at least months go ahead, and then blood splash and the squealing and the snorting and the screaming and the struggling. They know it. And then we consume that cortisol, that fear,
yep,
that was coursing through their bodies at the time of their horrible death. Why do we want to eat fear? And what does that do to us as human beings to eat that? I think probably nothing good.
This is what Santos Bonacci talks about, that as the animal goes through that process, that fear is just, it's embedded in the meat, it's embedded in the product, and then you're going to consume it. It's just, I don't know. It's very, very difficult to accept it once you see it and once you know it. It really is.
Well, they're not just feeding animals, primarily all the animals that are slaughtered in your grocery store and the eggs, et cetera, are GMO fed. But there's more than just that. Mm-hmm. There's genetically modified animals that animals have been genetically engineered themselves in some cases. It's an animal that contains additional or altered genetic material through the use of modern biotechnology tools.
Salmon is one of those.
Yes.
Yes.
They take biofarm animals is one. They genetically engineer the animal to produce human insulin for pharmaceutical use. But by the way, a lot of people who have diabetes in many cases are only having to take that insulin due to the fact of their diet and what the, you know, the effect, the domino effect that has caused, that has created a situation in which they have to inject insulin into their stomachs. So they are genetically engineering animals to produce human insulin. So they're doing that to animals. They've got these xenotransplant animals being engineered so they can be used as sources for cells and tissues and organs that can be used for transplantation into humans. But those humans are only, for the most part, needing those transplanted organs because the humans ruin their own organs through their diet. Now, yes, of course, there's car accidents or people born with some organ not fully formed and they might need a transplant. But generally speaking, when people are getting transplants, they've done something to their organ through their own fork and knife. There's animals that are made disease resistant, which sounds good and everything, but they've received modifications that make them resistant to things like mastitis. Mastitis is a very painful infection of the udder, but it's only in dairy cows, not in just regular cows who are nursing their young. It's when they have to put those things that milk them on their basically nipples and all that pulling and chafing. And by the way, there's an allowable level of pus allowed in milk, and it comes from that mastitis. So they're trying to work around by doing some genetically modifying animals to be resistant to mastitis. They're creating Frankenstein animals, so it's easier for us to use and abuse them. If this were done to humans, the people doing it would be put in jail. But instead, the people doing it are often subsidized by our governments, these farms and farmers, to continue doing what amounts to torture to these animals.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like I said, it's really disturbing, but this disturbing aspect of it, folks, it needs to be discussed.
And we can do something about it by voting with our pocketbook. That's the positive. That's the takeaway from all of this. And no matter what stage you are in changing your diet to be healthier or to be more kind to animals, it's in your hands. And people say, oh, you're not saving any animals by being vegan. I know that I don't use my money to buy things made of animals, and my home and body is not filled with animal suffering. And I feel good about that. And that to me right there is enough. And I'm also helping. I know it's a small way, but you know, the more of us do it, the better it is in the water that's used to clean these factory farms and to water the animals. That water then runs off. Well, that water could be used for humans, and we have droughts in some areas. That water then runs off into the streams, et cetera, and then pollutes tanneries used to tan leather to be used for our boots and our shoes and our bags and such. All those toxins go into the water supply. The land that the tanneries are built on, and the dairy farms and the chicken coops and all of this, that land could instead be used to grow crops to feed starving people. These are positives by changing into what our natural diet is, which is essentially veganism. I know we can eat anything we want, but our teeth are not designed to run up to a cow and chomp on it and kill it. Look at our teeth. People see the little fang teeth some of us have. That's only to hold the apple you're biting. That's not to rip through the flesh of a cow and crunch through bone. We don't have the speed. We don't have those springy legs that like a wildcat has that can chase down an animal. We don't have that jumping power that they have to jump on the back. We don't have the nails and claws to claw the animal. We don't have those things because we're not meant to kill animals. Well, people will say, well, we evolved. We have tools. We have guns. We have knives. But if you want to have the appeal to nature argument that eating meat is natural, then I say, friend, you go out there and kill it with your bare hands. I'll watch.
Yeah. And you know, your point about money talking and not putting your money into the killing the animals, you know, eating meat and stuff like that. Now, money does talk with these folks, because if you go back about 5 years ago, Patricia, when organic foods were really starting to get going and get some traction, I mean, the GMO food companies, they laughed. They said, oh, you know, that's a niche thing. It's not going to reach any kind of critical mass where people are going to eat organic food. So they didn't really concern themselves so much about it. But people changed their spending habits, and they spent their money in a different way. And when they started spending more money on organic food, then what happened was the GMO companies, well, they started to panic a little bit, and they started to wake up. Mm-hmm. Today, what happens is, I go to a local Kroger supermarket, and they have a whole organic section that didn't exist a few years ago.
Yes.
And so the point where people are saying, well, you're not really saving animals, you're not really doing this, and that's ridiculous, because if people start moving in mass in a certain direction, things will change. And I'm using the example of GMO to organic as an example, because it's a good one. And I remember back 4 or 5 years ago, they were saying, oh, well, organic food is just so expensive. You're not going to be able to afford that. I mean, our food is much cheaper, and, you know, it's just as healthy. Well, what happened was, as people were spending more money on more organic food was being put on the shelves.
Yes.
And the prices came down.
Very true.
You know, so it's really, it comes down to economics. So where people are saying or arguing with you or whoever that, you know, you're not really saving animals, you're not doing this, you're not doing that. No, money talks.
What you're saying is true. In 2017 alone, the demand for vegan and vegetarian food increased by, ready, 987%.
Yeah.
This has been amazing these past few years in the world of veganism and vegetarianism. People in the UK, due to the awareness of the health aspect and the animal aspect, are now eating 50% less beef. And there's a company in America, I think it's America-based, I'm not sure the name of the company, what their main product is called Beyond Meat, and it's a burger, and it's sold in many stores anyway in the meat department, but it's not made of meat. It's the burger that bleeds, and that's gross, but yet it has beet juice in it. And when you cook it, it's got that blood thing, which it wasn't really blood, but people think it is blood in meat. The fluid that we're used to seeing when you bite into a hamburger. It's got that. And I've had one before. I'm not into fake meats, but I try things occasionally and it's actually pretty good. You know, it's not a compromise. It's got that texture. It's got that barbecued meat taste on the grill sort of flavor of a hamburger. It's called Beyond Meat and you can find it in many stores in the meat section where you'd find your hamburger patties. So 40% of new dairy style products are vegan alternatives that they're coming up with now. They are saying that in the future, 25% of the UK vegan market will be growing 25% in the next 4 years. And there's another thing that even if people aren't vegan or vegetarian, that nearly 50% of Americans support a ban on slaughterhouses because people don't tie in slaughterhouse with what's on my plate. But when people see those videos, they see the animals. They don't want that to happen. When they're faced with it, they say, no, I don't want that. I want that banned. Also, there's a dating site that did a survey and found that vegans are, quote, by far the sexiest, with 62% of vegans receiving more online dating messages. So,
oh, there you go.
So if you want to be sexy, you want to be slim, you want to have that clear conscience, maybe a deeper spiritual connection with the world around you and the animals, you want to provide less pollution to the environment, and just feel good about what you're contributing and what you're not contributing, making the move toward a plant-based diet, if you want to call it that, or veganism, is really the way to go. I think it's a great time that we're doing this interview and at the dawn of 2018 in January, a lot of people get that gym membership going and they make all these resolutions. And if you feel that you want to do this, but you feel that backsliding when you see the Cheetos come out at a party or, you know, whatever, the cheese fondue or, you know, the grilling of the steak smells so good. You need to review some of the documentaries that we had mentioned earlier. Just watch a little bit of one on YouTube, a little bit of something like that. Or it'll put a picture in your mind and you'll say, as your hand is reaching for the package of chicken thighs, you'll say, no, those are my friends. They're not my food.
Well, Patricia, this has been an excellent conversation. And I'm so glad that you came on the show to talk about this. And like you said, it's the perfect time to talk about it. Beginning of the year and people have resolutions and so on. And maybe this is something that they'll have as a resolution, you know, to change their eating habits and to understand what we took them through here and be healthier for it at the end of the day. So again, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show. You're just a plethora of information on this, which I knew you would be. And I've learned a couple of things too. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Just a little bit of advice for anyone. Try to live more kindly, and this will lead you to this is an ultimate destination. And just at the very least, like David Weiss said, you know, you don't need to be completely vegan. Just try a vegan meal a day.
And that concludes another Sage of Quay interview, and I hope you enjoyed the discussion as much as I did. Links to my guests' websites and social media are listed in the show notes below. And as always, I'd like to thank everyone for listening and visiting the blog. You can get to the blog by typing in sageofquayradio.blogspot.com or simply head over to our hub website at sageofquay.com. Also, if you get a moment, please visit laborofloveMusic.com to listen to my album, Leaving Dystopia. And remember, live in truth and always serve creation. It's really that simple. See everyone next week. Be safe, enjoy, and God bless.